our media press conference here. I'm Mike Paz, and with me is our Grand Marshal for this weekend's festivities, the Historic Sports Car Racing Limited Weekend here at Watkins Glen, presented by Shewan Canal Trust. Brock Yates is with us here, and Brock, welcome to Watkins Glen.
I thought you were going to say the historic Brock Yates. That's going to be here.
I wasn't going to do that to you. Trust me when I tell you. Yeah, I mean, this place holds a lot of memories for you. We're very honored to have you as our Grand Marshal.
Well, I'm delighted to be here. Obviously, it's sort of my second home, and I've been here God knows how many decades now. It's just wonderful to see Watkins Glen in its glorious state right now. Great day. It's going to be a great weekend.
Now, you're the one that brought up the historic part of it, so tell us how long you've been coming here.
My father brought me here for the 1952 race. We sat on Old Corning Hill, and I remember it well. I remember the Cunninghams, and it was just a wonderful experience. And I guess probably after that, I didn't come back until the early 1960s. I came back when I was in college to the second, the Townsend, for this deal up here once. And only sat here for a while, just watching the race on a fence, like everybody else, I guess, didn't know that.
So you were impressed with the fact that they even put a purpose-built race facility up here in the 50s, and then when it went through its rebirth in 1971.
Well, it's been obviously, as Bill Green and all the historians have done such a masterful job, it's really the story of American road racing in so many different permutations, its rise and fall and rebirth, and it's a very dramatic story, and it really is representative of what's happened to this whole sport. So you can really trace the history of modern American road racing right in this 500-odd acres.
Well, I don't want to steal all the questions from the media, so let's get going here and ask the media if they have any questions for Brock Yates, our Grand Marshal, for our race festivities. Just raise your hand and ask away. Somebody's going to break the ice.
Tell us about the car you're running this weekend,
yeah.
Eliminator.
Brock's got a car here, and unusual, to say the least, if people are not familiar with your car. It doesn't look like a road racing car in first place.
Well, it's a California hot rod that was built for road racing by a guy named Duffy Livingston, who started the go-kart company. He was one of the early hot rodders. The car was originally built as a track roadster by a man by the name of Jay Chamberlain. Jay raced here a number of times. He was a Lotus factory driver in the later career, but he was originally a hot rodder. Built the car for dirt track racing in the Southern California area. Like the Rathman brothers and Troy Ruttman and Chamberlain raced with those guys. And then the car became obsoleted for track racing, and Duffy Livingston in 1954 built it into a road racing car. We've got all kinds of documentation of when the car was built. Hot Rod Magazine did a story on it in 54, and a lot of other stories. And it raced with the Ole Yellers and with the El Caballos and a number of other California hot rods. It raced extensively with the, and then we found it a couple of years ago and restored it, took it back to Monterey in 1997, which was kind of an interesting, we started the car last in a 10-lap race and finished eighth, past all the Ferraris in the race, which is kind of a hoot. Couple of D-type Jaguars, and we're not running very well this weekend, but when it runs, it's a pretty serious little race car.
What's in it? I mean, what's the power plant and some of the things about it?
Well, it's a 301 cubic inch Chevy. It started life with a flathead Ford, but if you go over and take a look at it, there's some funny things that it's really got the car's got a great sense of humor. It's all original. The bodywork is absolutely original. Has all the original decals, the original paintwork on the car. We preserved all of that. Underneath, it's all redone. But if you look at it closely, you'll see the brake ducts on the front axles are Japanese army helmets sawed in half. And there are a lot of other neat little things on the car. There's a World War II canteen uses one of the overflow cans inside the chassis, and it's a hoot. It's everybody looks at it and laughs, and it's kind of fun. We've enjoyed bringing it out.
You've always been a fan for the unusual. I mean, you've written in your columns about the unusual things you've seen in this sport.
Yeah, I guess it's been an unusual career. I'm always thinking about what I might have done had I not wasted my life around automobiles, like the rest of you people in this room.
All right, yes, sir.
Yes, here at the home of road racing in this country, I think you have to admit, though, that right now the dominant form seems to be oval track racing. What do you see as the future for road racing in this country? Is there a future for road racing?
Oh, there's unquestionably a future for road racing. We've got to get this organization issue done between the two sanctioning bodies. We've never been able to work effectively with them. So we need to get the sanctioning situation sorted out, and I think that will happen, but it's going to take a couple more years probably. But, oh yeah, there's an absolute future for road racing in the United States. And it's interesting that vintage racing is becoming so popular because it represents an awful lot of the kind of essence of road racing. I would like to see, if I had my druthers, I'd like to see artificial road courses disappear. I think they're awful, boring, stupid. And we should return, other than with a possible exception, Long Beach, which is pretty much a natural road course, it's kind of become that, but the rest of them are really awful. And I think that in a way it hurts American road racing to take it away from the natural courses and stick it on artificial circuits. I think it diminishes the strength and power and the appeal of road racing, which should take place in natural terrain like Watkins Glen.
Yes, sir.
Brock, you've raced on many tracks around the United States. How does Watkins Glen stack up to all the other tracks? I'll put you on the spot here.
No, you won't. Watkins Glen is ranks with, in my opinion, with Road America, Road Atlanta, possibly Mid Ohio, Laguna Seca, they represent the best of. So it's in, you know, it's a world class racetrack. It's a kind of there's a patina about Watkins Glen that's like Yankee Stadium or the Rose Bowl. It has all this history, and I think everybody that runs on this racetrack gets a sense of that history. I mean, you're running on the same surfaces that most of the great race drivers of the modern era have run here. And that's kind of a wonderful experience for virtually everybody that goes out there. There's a sense that I get, and I think everybody does that is here, has a moment when you think, oh my God, I'm running where Sterling Moss ran. I'm running on the same pavement that the Villeneuve's ran on and on and on. I mean, I just can't tell you how much history there is here. So that's a great. I think that's what makes Watkins Glen. And it's a very difficult and interesting racetrack too. So it's got all the ingredients.
Difficulty factor.
Sure.
You said difficult. What is the most difficult part of the track here?
Well, I think to me on the big racetrack, the left-hander coming down off the hill is that's a little off camber and it's pretty tricky stuff down in there. But of course, with a Winston Cup car, I've never driven a Winston Cup car in the short track, but there the intensity of the competition, I think, transcends the difficulty of the racetrack. That's the short course here is probably not that difficult, but it's wide and it's fast, and put three of those things abreast all the way around here, it becomes a different kind of a road course. But as far as technique is concerned, I wouldn't imagine that this racetrack is particularly difficult technique-wise, compared to, say, Laguna Seca or Road Atlanta, which is probably the most difficult, challenging racetrack in the United States. But it's a very fast, very very difficult racetrack to run really quickly and fast on, no question about it.
Thank you.
More questions for Brock? Tell us a little bit about your life right now and what you're doing and what you plan to do for the future.
Well, I just finished a book called Outlaw Machine, which was published by Little Brown last year in hardcover. It's called Harley Davidson, The Search for the American Soul. It just came out in paperback by Dell this month. And so it's been printed in German and Japanese and a whole bunch of different languages. And I'm getting ready to do another book. I'm not sure what I'm going to do, but I've got some things in mind. But I'm going to talk to my agent before I talk about it publicly.
An exclusive deal. Hurley Haywood, come on up here if you would, please. Ladies and gentlemen, Hurley Haywood has driven many, many races here at the Glen, and certainly all over the world. most accomplished road racers. I joked with them over at the autograph session that if we started listing all of your accomplishments, it might take us to the next time you run a vintage race here to probably list them all. You've had that long and great career.
I love coming up to the Big Glen. My first race here was in 1969 in a 911S that I shared with Peter Gregg. He sort of was the one that started me off in racing. And I had a bootleg FIA license through NASCAR. And we came up here, and all the SCCA guys were having a heart attack because they said, who's this kid? How does he have an FIA license? So we started the racing. We won our class, and that was kind of the start of it. And the Glen, the Glen really, to me, is a place that is just wonderful to race on. And a lot of the reasons why it's wonderful to race on is because of the people that are involved. Like where I've stayed in the same room at the Glen Motor Court since 1969. So when I come up here, it's kind of like coming back up to home.
Questions for Hurley, because I know you all want to talk with him. Any kind of questions at all about his career? Yes, sir.
I know you've been racing Porsche 911s for many years. How did you get started and decided racing with Porsche?
Well, when I went to college, I had a very fast Corvette that I used to race at autocrosses. And one weekend, I was at an autocross in Jacksonville, Florida, and Peter Gregg arrived at that autocross with his big transport, with his race car in the transport. And he wanted to test something at that autocross because next weekend he was going to do a pro race. And at that point, I didn't know who Peter Gregg was from cracking a wall. So, bottom line was I beat him with my Corvette, and he came up and he said, you got to be pretty good to beat me, and that's how we became friends. I had indicated to him that I wanted to start professional racing. I had talked my father into helping me support for 2 years, and he gave me an agreement that if I did it, I would, after 2 years, I would have to continue on at that level on my own, which meant that I was going to have to make enough money to keep on going. So I started with Peter. He took me under his wing, and of course he was with Porsche. So the car I started with and the car that I concentrated on was a Porsche. I have stayed with Porsche ever since.
How appropriate the Porsche parade starts just as Hurley starts talking about it. Some more questions for Hurley Haywood. Yes, sir.
Hurley, best car you've ever raced, most difficult car you've ever raced?
Well, probably the most difficult car was the 917-10. That was a Can-Am car that we raced here at the line in the 1973 Can-Am series and half of the 74 Can-Am series. It was difficult to drive that car because, one, it was a short wheelbase car and it had about 1,100 horsepower. And I had started driving that car really with no prior experience to big horsepower cars. I came fresh out of a 911 and went into that car. So it was a big learning curve for me. We were pretty successful. We were third in the championship behind Donahue and Fulmer. But it was truly a difficult car to drive. And when I drive, we were, after the 74 season was over, I sold my car to Basha Polak for nothing. I think it was $40,000. And he took it out to California, put it in his showroom, kept it there until 1992, which we bought that car, we almost bought that car back from him, paid considerably more than I had sold it to him.
How much was that?
a lot more than what I sold it to him for. So that was probably the most difficult. Every race car has a special feeling for me, and everyone has its good points and its bad points. I think, though, probably the most enjoyable car, really, it was really a lot of fun to drive. It was the 936, which was an open car that we ran at Le Mans for 3 years, and that was the later versions of that car had the Porsche Indy engine in it, and with that motor, it was just terrifically balanced car. It was a flat bottom car. It got its downforce from aerodynamics, and it was just a lot of fun to drive.
Thank you.
More questions for Hurley Haywood or Brock Yates? They're both still here.
We've got a couple youngsters in the audience here. Hurley, what advice would you have for young kids that are looking to get into racing today?
How many times have you been asked that question?
Rob a bank. it's very difficult to get started in racing, and I'm asked that question probably a couple times a week with email coming into my office about kids that are 16 and 17 years old who want to get going in racing, and I really truly don't have an answer for them except that, you know, you never have to, you never should give up. It's something that if you really are serious about it, that you can find a way if you don't have the resources to start. Most of the guys now in racing either are from very famous families in motor racing, or their families have a lot of money to start to help them get established and recognized. That's a problem. The series that youngsters can compete in, you need a budget of $100,000 or $200,000 a year to run in a series where you can be evaluated. And then once you're evaluated and somebody sees some natural talent, then the road gets easier. But getting that start, to give you an example, when I started racing, in a 911S. The cost of the car at that point was about $10,000. And the cost of maintaining it for a series for a year was probably around $50,000 or $60,000. So you could do a very professional program for well under $100,000. Today, getting that same exposure and at the same level would cost you $1 million. So it's just a very, very hard thing to, and that's one of the things that is wrong in this country. In Europe, they have a very, very structured ladder that young people are able to go up, and each rung in that ladder is a price point. So there's a logical step mechanism to get up to the big leagues, and we don't really have a farm league. It's kind of like NASCAR.
Brock Yates has an additional comment about that.
I think Sweet Savage once told me a long time ago, and I think had not Sweet been killed, he probably would have been one of the great racing drivers of the modern era. He said anything, motorcycles, go-karts, get on the racetrack. If you can't afford, a lot of people stand around and wait to get into some kind of a racing car. I think Hurley would agree that the environment of a racetrack, the starts, the competitive wheel-to-wheel competition, no matter what kind of machine you're in, is a mindset that's very important to establish, almost as much as it is developing the technique of actually driving a car. I think shifter carts are unbelievably a great place to start now. Keep in mind that most of the Brazilians that are coming up and dominating kart in the IRL started in go-karts. Any kind of racing, think about Jeff Ward running at the Speedway, came out of motorcycles, motocross. Robbie Gordon and Rick Mears came out of off-road. So if you're good, you're good. And sooner or later you'll develop the level of skill and a reputation that will lead you into better kinds of racing. Unfortunately, I think Hurley will agree that he said earlier, he made mention of the fact that in road racing, there isn't a very logical step forward. In England, for example, the open wheel, England or Europe, or even in the South America, the open wheel kids race get so much more seat time than they do in the United States. There's a Formula Atlantic series of 12 or 14 races. That's nothing compared to what guys have to run. The kids that are coming out from South America have endless hours in race cars. And our kids have almost no time in open wheel cars and are expected to go out and be ready to race at in kart or the IRL. I think that's why road racing is our representation is as small as it is, because we're not giving our drivers the experience that they need to get up to that level.
More questions for Hurley or Brock?
Yes. Just a comment on that. My son races quarter midgets. As
the sport is growing tremendously, so I think in the future you will see a lot more of American influence in these series that the Europeans seem to dominate. And if anybody's interested in quarter midget racing, chase me down, because there's clubs not too far from here. Yeah. And if anybody's interested in finding out more about it, chase me down or hang around for a little bit if anybody is.
Hurley, when was the very first inkling that you knew you wanted to drive a race car?
I started driving a full-size automobile when I was 12 years old. We had a farm outside of Chicago, and they built a special seat for me and blocks on the pedals. So I started driving when I was pretty young, but I really didn't think about racing until I was in high school. I went through my senior year down to Sebring to sort of check out what that was all about, and absolutely fell in love with the whole ambiance of racing and the whole idea. And then I got a Corvette and I started racing that on autocrosses and really got kind of fell in love with it. And Peter, who connected with me very early in my career, saw it's kind of a natural ability, and he sort of capitalized on that ability. He took me, after we had gotten my first race car, he took me up to Savannah to teach me how to drive it. And after the first day, I was better than he was, so he knew he had something that was pretty good. So it was relatively a short period of time from the time I actually decided that, yeah, I want to do this, to the time I got the chance to get into a real race car.
Further questions?
I have a question.
Yes, go ahead.
How would you compare the American involvement of the Cadillac, the YMD, to the factory versus today, or even when you were racing?
The factory involvement today versus when you first started?
Well, when I first started, the factory involvement, I mean, factories sort of come and go. And throughout my racing career, I've always been associated with the Porsche factory. With Porsche, it's an absolute honor to drive one of their cars, and the chances of you winning the races are greatly increased because Porsches are very reliable. Porsche has been basically connected with sports car racing for as long as I've been racing, and they don't seem to come in and out of it based on the change of the wind. They're in for the long run. Other manufacturers, and I've seen them all, come and go, come in, they make a big splash, they accomplish what they want to do, and then they leave. The Cadillac program, you mentioned the Cadillac, and it's a very ambitious project, but I think that when they get to Le Mans, as they already are starting to realize, that it's not so easy. And people and manufacturers build cars just for that one race. They don't really care about how much it costs to build a car just for one race, because Le Mans is the most important race in the world. If you can win Le Mans from a manufacturer standpoint, that is worth hundreds of millions of dollars in your advertising for selling cars. So I think, you know, the Cadillac is going to have their hands full in Le Mans this year. Audi, who is certainly the favorite. I have raced for the factory, Audi factory, before, and I know what kind of a job they're going to do, and they have absolutely got, you know, tens of thousands of miles of testing in preparation for the race. So I think on them, but it's interesting, and racing, in my opinion, needs factory involvement, because the factories bring, you know, the drivers, they bring all of the fancy stuff that fans like to look at. So you need them, but you have to be a little bit wary of some of the things that they want to accomplish. So it has to be some kind of meeting.
Hurley Haywood, Rock Yates, thanks for coming up and being part of our media day here today. One final comment?
Yeah, Mike, I'll add my suggestion for a Cadillac. Cheat. What I would do is I'd go right down to Mooresville, North Carolina, and get one of those guys that do those wonderful cheater motors and build a monster and go out there and at least lead one lap, then blow up. Lead one lap. That's all I'll tell Cadillac. So I think that's my recommendation to those guys. Nitro, I don't care what they do, but lead a lap before they go home.
Go on, Brock, nobody cheats in racing.
Possible to believe in it.
Ladies and gentlemen, you've seen two of the best, two of the legends here in our media center here today. Hurley Haywood, Brock Yates, our grand marshal. Thanks for coming down.